To let everybody know that, and I've already said it, but I'm going to say it again.
We're getting started.
Up the stairs, and everybody that's got kids here, if everybody would help us keep an eye on them, because when we get to worshiping, we might need some help watching the kids. We don't want them outside at all. That's another reason I did not have those bathrooms out there, so we can kind of keep an eye on them. After we get going, we'll shut this door here. Not that we don't want people to come in, but if somebody sees the door open, you know, we've got kids. We gotta keep
we're getting started.
So when we get to worshiping, sometimes you lose yourself when you're watching. We have Stacy. Can you introduce yourself? She has a flag ministry and she makes flags. She brought flags. So if you would like to worship with her flag, she doesn't mind if you use one of her flags. Just that's if you just want. We've got plenty of room. We have room back there. We've got room up here. Just we want everybody to worship God. It's not about anything but just get raw with God. If there's not a protocol, whatever you have to do to make contact with the Heavenly Father, and you want to know He hears you, just do what you got to do. If it's just talking and sitting quietly, we've even got chairs in the corner back there. If you want to be alone, you can just walk back there, sit and pray. We just want everybody to find that little spot where they can have that one-on-one with Jesus tonight. And that way you leave changed. You don't leave the same way you came. Because that's not the way He works. If you encounter God, you won't be the same. It don't matter if you have known Him for a long time, or just for a short time, or never at all. This is the place to get to know Him if you don't know Him, and if you do know Him, to get more of Him, or get a deeper walk, and more a different experience, or just hear His voice. So that's what we are all about, is entertaining the presence and the Spirit of God, and calling heaven to come down to earth. Because we're reaching up, He's definitely going to be reaching down. Actually, I think He's going to be pouring down the rain, His Spirit. So as we move into our service, I want to introduce Tiffany. She's our guest here, Tiffany Blackwell. And she is, I'm just going to give you a little background on her right quick. I had it up, but it's moved. Uh-oh. I can't tap on that. Because that's the low fee. I don't want that. Mom's trying to be very cooperative with her. It's insane. Anyway, she is Emergent University, where she teaches. Can I let you tell?
Yes.
Because if I can't read it. Okay, you guys. I am Tiffany Blackwell. I am the founder and the president and dean of Emergent University. I also am the apostle of the Prophetic Pools Prayer House. Love Jesus, and people invite me to be a special guest and just come, because you know who's the special guest though? It's Jesus. Jesus, He is the special guest. He's the one that's invited here. Father, you're invited. Jesus, you're invited. Holy Spirit, you're welcome here to have your way. And you know what? I'm just somebody just like you who decided to say yes to Holy Spirit so that He can use me, that He can use you, He can flow through. It's just being willing and saying yes. Oh, God in heaven, we thank you for your miracles. Thank you, Tiffany. And also, I want to tell you, we have anointing oil up here. You're welcome to use it. And tissue. And we also have prayer calls. So if you have somebody that you know that needs a miracle, or that you just feel like they need something to remind them that God has not forgotten them, that's what I think a prayer call is for. You might have a physical need. Might be a spiritual need. It might be just that it's hard for you to maybe you're struggling with an addiction. And to me, a prayer cloth that's been prayed over, and you see it, you put it somewhere where you see it. And if you want to give it to somebody, that's the same thing. It's just a reminder that God has not forgotten. God has not forgotten. It may take a little time. I don't know His will. I don't know His way. But I can trust whatever it is, in the perfect time, it will come to pass. And sometimes miracles happen instantly. Sometimes it's not instantly, but that doesn't mean it hasn't already happened in the Spirit. It just means the timing for the evidence of it, for us to see, for us to know, hasn't come to pass. Because before the foundations of the earth, all of this was
already created. You and I were created before the foundations of the earth. Even before we were seated in our mother's womb, He knew us. He made our book. He knows the start to the finish. So tonight is just another page in your book, in your story. And how it's written is up to you and I. How it's written, how it comes out looking, it's up to us. And He knows how He wants it to be and how it should be. But when you say yes to Jesus, it will come and it will be like He wants it to be. So we're going to just open our hearts right now, and I'm going to open us up in prayer. Heavenly Father, I just want to thank You for each and every individual that has come here. They came here with a hungry heart. Before this meeting ever came about, there's things that individuals that are here tonight have asked You for. There's needs, there's wishes, there's hopes, there's desires. But a hope deferred only makes the heart, whew. We're not going to defer the hope tonight. We're going to call it out in Jesus' name. Call it down. And Your power and Your glory will manifest itself here tonight. We ask for impartation, manifestation, and a deep moving of Your Spirit so that we all leave with a sweet, sweet presence of the Holy Spirit in our hearts. And even if there are some here tonight that don't have their prayer language, let it happen tonight. Because that's a direct line to You, and it's a direct line that the enemy cannot interfere. He cannot interfere. So what comes from Your heart goes straight to His ears. And You can hear, and You are ministered to directly by the Heavenly Father. So tonight, Lord, I ask You to let the ground of our heart, let the flesh of our heart be soft, not stony. And if it is stony, soften us. Whew.
In the middle of a storm, stay faithful, and you stay constant. You are a faithful Father to the end.
Yeah.
Oh,
especially as a man, that you know, even for women, so we just had so much pressure with just life. There's just so many expectations. And what's crazy, you know, I kind of thought about it, was like, it's not expectations of God, it's like worldly expectations. You know, we wake up and you go to work, and you gotta work because you gotta pay the bills. The bills don't stop, it don't matter. You know, you can't be like, oh, well, you know, I love Jesus and can you give me an extension? They're like, oh, that's good, but nah, it ain't gonna happen. And it's just crazy because, you know, the enemy just gives us so many lies. We just hear so much just garbage. It's hard to filter. And just everyday life just goes on and on and on. And a lot of times we sit back and we ask ourselves, like, you know, am I even up to today? And sometimes we get, you know, that sense of depression, like, I don't even want to move forward. Like, I don't even want to get out of bed. You know what I'm saying? And that's a real thing, you know. And I felt that way. I've been to the point where, you know, I didn't have a job, couldn't find a job, made the wrong decisions. You know, my wife's up there. We moved to Atlanta. And, you know, I'm pretty responsible, you know. I've been managing my whole life, and I've always been just kind of ahead of everything. And so I said, I moved to Atlanta. This is going to be awesome. You know, I didn't pray about it. I was like, you know, this has got to be God, because I'm moving to Atlanta, and it's going to be awesome for me. You know, I'm going to find a job like that. It's just going to be just amazing. And we got to Atlanta, and boy, the first decision. And I couldn't find a job. Was depressed, got a job, injured myself, was out of work even more, and it was just the worst. Just depressed, and you know, for a man to not have a job and not be able to supply for his family, it's just the worst. You know, you just kind of sit back and you think, you know, to the point where I was getting class every time I could. But we got to the point where we were going to fund our grandparents, because we just didn't have, we had nothing. We sold everything we had. We bounced from house to house. It just was the worst. And, you know, recently, I've been writing some spoken word stuff. It just been coming to me. And, you know, I'm not sure about y'all, but my shower time is my Jesus time. The kids are asleep, as you see them running around already, but you know, that's your time to kind of unwind. And so I wrote a few things that I want to share with one of them. I guess I bounced back and forth. But so this one, it doesn't have a title. Some of them do.
Loving you makes me sick and it's ruining my life. So I fight to be a true son. will choose God all the days of my life. He will fight this fight and he will run my life. I'm done running with you. It's over.
Absolutely.
Amen.
And, you know, that just seems so true because it's so crazy that a lot of times we just kind of go through life and we believe the lies that everybody's saying. We believe that the things that people speak into us. And it just, you know, God has just caused for us to be great. But think of the words that you have heard just throughout your life. Think of just the doubt and the fear that people have put inside of you and told you what you can and can't do and told you what you can and can't be and who you are. And we believe it because we were 6 and 7. And how many of those words still affect you today?
Come on.
And we sit there and we think that it does, and we wonder, where does this come from?
Come on.
What is going on? And why do I feel the way that I feel? And God just kind of put on my heart, it's kind of like a house. So if you never bought a house or if you've seen a house, you know, a house is, you know, you got a 5-point inspection. Or when you go to the house, you know, you look at it. You know, a lot of us, we look at the frills and stuff, but, you know, you watch House Hunters and you're like, you know, they're like, oh, these walls are green. I don't want to buy this house. I'm like, that house is beautiful, you know? I'm like, green, you can paint that, you know? So, and, but it's a start to our foundation. And a lot of us have broken foundations. And, you know, if you know anything about a house, that's one of the hardest things to repair. You can't have a broken foundation and say, well, let's just fix it. That's nothing. It's the same thing with our spirit. Inside of us, like, our foundations, some of our foundations are broken from way back when. And we have to get with Christ to understand, like, where did this come from? Why is my foundation so shaky? And I understand why every time I try to stand on God that I'm always slipping and I'm always falling. And I don't understand that when someone gives me a word, I don't understand and I can't connect with it. It's because your foundation is not solid. And it comes from just the brokenness that people have spoken to your life. You didn't grow up on a broken foundation. Yeah, we were born into sin, but at the same time, we're born just with like you think about kids. Kids, they don't know. They just run, they have joy. God said, come to him as a child. Why? Because they understand and they just believe.
Yes. Yes.
If we tell them Jesus is real, they say, okay, cool. If I tell you Jesus is real, you say, well, I don't see him because of my bills. I don't see them because I got bullied in school. I don't see them because I was sitting there and this person cursed me out. And when I go to work, I hate this person. This person got issues with me and this person does this to me. So I don't see how God, why does God let all this happen? It's because he's right there, reaching out his hand. And because we're so broken and shaky, we can't see. It disrupts our view of what God, where God actually is. So he's right in front of you, but because you're walking, your foundation is shaking. You're sliding to the left of the road, and you can't see him.
Come on.
He's right in front of me, and I know who this means. So I can sit here and tell you, I'm not just saying anything just to say, like, oh, he just stepped up there telling you, but that's how it is. And it's not until you have to do the work. When you rebuild a foundation of a house, you're not just simply going to slap some concrete on there. You want everything so quick and easy because the problem is so rough that how can I fix this quick? How can I get a quick solution? See, we always want everything so fast. And see, we have to dig. See, we have to go under the foundation, pull it back, lift it up, repair it, put more ground up under it, and then get a solid foundation. And then even at that, you're not done.
Come on.
Because you have to look, how's your roof? How's the plumbing inside of you? Which is our emotions. And I can tell you right now today that my emotions are probably worth for me and I, 0. because I was raised and born, and my mom, she's right over there. But I was raised that as a man, that you pulled that in. And where I grew up on the east side of Cleveland. And so there was no room to be soft. There was no room to, and even regardless of the east side of Cleveland, even for your own life, single mothers, mama, there's no room to be soft. But that's the way the world tells you, which is crazy. And that's just like I said, that's the lies that the enemy tells. So the lies that told us is that there's no room to be soft. So in turn, we set upon these generational curses. So we teach there's no room for you to be soft. There's no room to be soft. Miss Mary, there's no room to be soft. Miss Lord, there's no room to be soft. Because when you go out in this world will eat you up and spit you out. So you need to have strength. You need to hold back your emotions. You need to put that stuff down. Because God is nothing, that don't matter. Because when you get to the real world, well, guess what? The real world is Jesus.
That's right.
He said that we build our foundation on him.
Yep.
And I know that to be true because everything that I've tried doesn't work. That's
true. Come on.
And if everything I try isn't working, then it got to be something. You know, we went to a banquet last night. It's a teen challenge of Alabama. And, man, a lot of those guys, man, their stories are just, and you sit back and you're like, oh, dang.
Come on.
I ain't been through none of that. And a lot of them say, like, I went to this rehabilitation center. I tried to do it on my own. I tried to do this. And yeah. See, that's even with me. I tried to do it on my own. I tried to realize that I don't need God because I can do this myself. Look at my credentials. I'm already verified in the world, so the world's going to accept me, right? Wrong. They not. They don't care. They're looking at you as just a disposable tool. See, we tend to just keep walking and we dismiss God. And I have one in this. I'm actually worried about it. It's I'm not sorry. This one's entitled, I'm Still Finding Something. I love the lies that the enemy told, and I love the lies that the enemy showed. And I love the way that makes me feel when he has given me the cheap thrills that keep me locked and bound as my everyday feeling. It's like I'm going to drown under the weight of how I will disappoint. And who will disapprove? I like the fake sense of being approved. I like not recognizing my full potential, even though in my job I always feel so little. I love the double standards of heartbreak, breaking love. I love having the feeling as if I'm never enough. I sit awake at night thinking, what should I do? I sit awake at night and I think, what should I do? Continue living the lie, or should I be like you? Should I stand tall above it all? I walk in your promise. Should I never be scared and take a leap of faith? Should I stare back at evil and punch it in the face? Should I never feel alone and scared? Should I embrace the life that you created for myself? But the same life that you said would probably bring me no wealth is the life that is not easy. It's covered in blood. It's a life that's where I drag my feet. I walk up these mountains. You say you'd be with me all of my days. You say you protect me from all my ways. You show me time and time again that you love forever. I think I'll go this time. I think I'll call it forever. I love what Jesus does because he is my refuge. But wait, what's that sound? Wait, what's that smell? It's the sound and smell of familiarity. And it's so sweet to me. I mean, Jesus sounds great. Jesus sounds so cool, but it's not easy being an outcast in school. And you don't know how hard it is to stand out at work. And my friends don't like me if I drop off this earth. So give me a chance to love you when it's more convenient for me. Give me a chance to love you when I can truly see. I know it's not something that I should be debating, but he makes it so easy. I'm still trying to say.
Oh.
And to an extreme, we talk about following Satan, but how many of you follow your friends?
Come on.
How many of you follow the Bible? How many of you follow the insecurities and the sex and the humiliating other people and the gossip and the tea? How many of you are following that? So take Satan out of the picture. So let's just say that because he's there. But how many of you are following? What are the things that are bringing you away from Christ? See, a lot of us, we change our heart. See, all we stand up and we say, God, I changed my life. I want to follow you. I know you are Jesus. You're my Lord and Savior. I love you. I'm covered by the blood. I'm good. Bam. My salvation is in you. Boom, go ahead. And then how many of us just put them to the side? You know, and I lived that in Dallas Young business. Like, you ever seen somebody with a broken phone? And you're like, man, what are you doing? You know, and they drop it in water, and then we want to be so broken, and we say, hey, just put in some rice. Yeah, that's the solution, right? Drop the front one, put in rice, some rice, something like that. I still don't understand how that. I don't think you put in like some potatoes, some mashed potatoes, you know, drop it down. But how many of us just want to just drop me in some rice? But you didn't fix the problem.
Come on.
So now your insides are all jacked up, but you feel like, oh, because I can charge it, and then the screen is still damaged. Well, I can answer the phone.
Come on.
So now we've created this faith. You know, I see a lot in my household about creating your environment. And you want to create an environment where Jesus can live.
Come on.
And you have to watch what you're doing. You got to watch what you're doing, what you're bringing in. So as we are following people and others, and we're conforming to our job because at work I have to be this way, and if I don't do this, then I won't fit in, and if I don't do this, I won't get that promotion. If I don't come around this way, if I don't talk to this person, then I won't set myself up for these opportunities. But God said, all you got to do is set yourself up for me. You speak to me, and I'm giving you everything. Because when you walk, if you truly, truly have said, I'm going to give myself to Christ, you'll see how doors will just fly open. Stuff that you wouldn't even think. You know, for me, I've been trying to walk my heart. I'm not going to say I'm perfect, because I'm not. But it was so crazy. So I'm a chef here in Romeo. And I'm never going to get hungry. So not one day. And the things that God has put in me, and some of y'all can tell that some of y'all eat my food. I actually had the convention center call me, and they wanted me to be the executive chef for the convention center. Over at convention center, Sanger Theater, the Mobile City Center. Not one day in culinary school. And there's people probably line up for that position. But God called me and moved into ministry, so I turned it down. But guess what? A lot of us think that, because the enemy will give us gifts as well. See, he'll speak to you. He'll speak to you in a way that pleases your soul. Just like I said, it feels so good. It sounds so good to me. And so guess what? That smells good. So I think I'm going to go here and dabble in that. When God's saying, I'm calling you to do this. And I just encourage you today to just get your house in order. And I'm not talking about your house. Don't go home and say, I told you you need to clean it up, you know.
Yeah.
You need to clean up after yourself, be nasty. But get your house. What is your house, yourself?
Yes.
Sit back and ask God, Lord, show me why my foundation is broken. Yeah. Yeah. And work through me to fix it. Show me where you want me. And I guarantee you God will speak to you. You may not like the answer, but when you walk in, it will definitely build a foundation to build everything else.
That's right.
That's all I got.
Thank you, Jonathan. Thank you, Jonathan. Thank you.
Yes, please.
Thank you. I'm so glad that y'all came out. That was amazing. He and I don't know each other personally. I think this is the first time I've met you. I don't even know if we're friends on Facebook. Okay. And so this is cool. This is amazing. Do you mind taking a minute and see if it, I don't know if you want to go this way or what, but one of the things that I thought was very interesting is that we are in sync tonight with what I'm speaking on this evening. One of the things that I'm speaking on is, the Lord told me, he said, speak on the tsunami. And I said, well, Lord, you know, they're by the water, they hear these terms all the time. Won't this just kind of be blasé? You know, just, you hear this all the time. Water, waves, tsunami, you know, whatever, all these water terms. And I said, Lord, won't that be boring? But anyway, he said, I wanted to talk to them about the soul. I wanted to talk to them about these things and issues or whatever. And in Revelation 11, 13, he talks about the earthquake. And then it just goes on from there. It says, the Lord told me essentially what these verses are talking about. It says, the earthquake in your life, those life circumstances, the foundation. You know, you thought you had the right foundation, but you're on the wrong foundation. And it's got the cracks and everything like that.
It's okay. It's okay.
And so in Revelation 11, 13, it begins to talk about how the earthquake in your life causes a tsunami. Doesn't work it like that, but that's what happens. You might think, wait a second, this tsunami, that verse is basically saying Revelation 11, 13 about how the dragon, it's saying the dragon now, is spewing water out of its mouth after the woman who's giving, she's giving birth. Is angry at the things you're birthing in your life and finally deciding to do things God's way. And he said, oh, honey, there's something jacked up in your life. There's something jacked up about what's going on in your life. And you might notice that when these earbuds in. So people on the live stream can hear as well. Okay. And so when the earthquake comes and all the shaking comes, we feel like our life is falling apart. But see, you pray for it. 2 Chronicles 7:14, my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and do what? Repent, seek God's face, and I will hear from heaven. So you've been praying for it. You've been saying it, crying, desperate. Lord, change my circumstances. Lord, change my life. And he came in and he spewed, the dragon spewed that tsunami, the water out. Come on. How many of us try and do that in our lives? We're like, it'd be like a broken house, and you just go, well, I'm going to paint it real good, and we're going to put some spackling on that. So, you know, we're going to call that. I think it's going to hold together okay. No, the first good wind called Ruach Hakodesh from the Lord God Almighty, as it comes in as Ruach Hakodesh, it comes in and blows the rest of the path that you try to hold together, that will help. Because it's not helping you, it's harming you, it's blowing you over. This is really, this is what I love. He and I do not collaborate, but Holy Spirit did. Look at that. This, I mean, what I wrote is right. She was watching me, the kids were talking to me, and I can't talk to y'all right now, please. And they're like,
you just preach that you want somebody to come down here and just let it all out, but they had all this bottled up inside, and now haven't had a voice and you couldn't do anything. God will give you that joy in Psalm 46 and 4 that it talks about. The rivers turn to blood, Revelation 16 and 4 talks about that. You might be thinking, this river that I keep talking about, it's also that tsunami wave. It's like the ocean that comes in and floods. All this great, wonderful stuff's at the bottom of the ocean, but it's getting hidden away because we built on the wrong foundation and tried to cover it up. It's almost like we created our own capstone over the fountain of God. And he's like, oh, not gonna have that. You finally accepted me. You loved yourself. That false capstone, that thing that the enemy convinced you to agree with, to put on top of the river so it couldn't be flowing, so you were stagnant and you were capped off. God burst through in his mercy, his grace, and that enemy's power. He comes in and he rips that capstone off, and you begin to flow, you begin to trickle. And sometimes it feels like you're losing your mind if that tsunami comes in. But what was at the bottom of those waters? What was there? Anytime you see waters come in from the Gulf or other areas and they come inland, nobody really wants that in one respect. But every time it does happen, there's a stirring up. And although there seems to be destruction, there's also life that comes with that water. There's life, things are stirred up.
That's right.
And life, new life begins to come into form. And things that you didn't even know existed, suddenly you're like, where'd that come from? Oh my gosh. And you begin to see new growth and new life, and where it was a desert, where you were dead. Things in your life maybe weren't prospering. Now they're still prospering. You've got things overflowing, and that wealth is overflowing, and the wealth is his joy and his love. The wealth can be finances, but don't ever think wealth is only money. That's way more than that. Suddenly, you don't have a bad relationship to try to steal all the money. Now you've got people who just want to love you just because you are alive and you can't give them one thing, and that's okay. They don't mind. They don't care. They love you! And you can't do anything for them. They can't sell you. They can't purchase you. There's nothing they're wanting from you. So it makes me smile sometimes. Kind word. And it confuses. It's confusing. Why aren't they trying to use me? Why aren't I need to perform. I need to do something to make them care and love me. But they seem to have agape love, the kind of love God has. And it confuses those who've always been abused. When you finally get the right relationship, that's what the tsunami brings. The right relationship, the right people. It straightens. You get the right job. Yeah. Come the right connections, the right seat. Sometimes that wind of God in that tsunami, it comes with the blessings of God, but sometimes it moves you to a different city.
That's right.
And you think, it's ripping me away from my family. I'm dying in the desert. But that's when your relationship with the Lord. Do you realize my child died? That was the sweetest time and the worst time of my life all at the same time. I was angry at God for years and didn't know until my son died. And finally, I blew up at the Lord and told him, you don't know what it's like to lose a son. You don't know what it's like to lose a child. Well, that was kind of dumb, as we all know. Jesus was standing there beside me smiling at me, and I kind of looked over at him, and I'm like, oh, I guess you do. That was dumb. But it had been rolling around in my head for 3 months, and I finally said it out of my mouth, shouted it in the Lord's face. I realized how stupid it was, but sometimes we have these things, we think they're real, we say it out of our mouth, and go, my gosh, that was a retarded lie from the enemy. Sometimes, I understand you thinking that you don't have to say it. There are sometimes when it's you and God and you're having it out, I have to say, God, I'm so sorry, I had to take off with you. I didn't realize how much I hated you till then. But I loved God. But I also hated him. It was a love-hate relationship, and didn't know the hate side even existed until then. And it was good that I got that off my chest. It was good that I got that off my chest. It's okay to tell the Lord I forgive you, even though he did nothing wrong. It was my perception of events all throughout my whole entire life, and the greatest amount of healing you could imagine took place there in that time. I remember holding my son and thinking, how terrible. I need to wake up. This can't be happening. And yet it happened. And some of you have been through some very terrible tragedies in your life. It may not have been your son that died or your daughter. It could have been a divorce. It could have been a custody battle. It could have been know, in 2010, everything about my life seemed destroyed, and I only had the one thing left, and that was I was a woman in ministry. And do you know what the audacity of God, do you know what he did? A few years ago, I was a homeschooling, home-making woman. That was say. Massive doors of opportunity opening. And they already opened, is the thing. And the enemy keeps trying to pull like this dark curtain in front of it, where you can't see where it is. And so we just speak right now. We veil that is over your eyes from the enemy in any way, shape, or form is ripped off. You can't see. You might not touch your eyes. Okay. We just speak right now. On your eyes, a greater measure of spiritual sight, spiritual increase right now.
That's right.
As you're praying and you're praising, your feet are standing in it. It looks like you're barefooted in the realm of the spirit, but you're not.
Amen.
One of your precious fruit
dies. Ooh, Jesus.
It's eviscerating serpents, scorpions, the things
of
the world
that we train
on. Every day, you're doing that. And he is so good.
Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
And for those of you who don't know, especially if you have an infirmity in your body, here's some things you might not know about. Financially, things are doing, you know, it's popping more than my way. The Lord's blessing in so many ways. I have a paid for house in ministry. Physically, I've overcome, let's see, I was sterile and birthed 7 children. I have rheumatoid arthritis, it's medically documented. I've been healed with that. They actually retested me years later, and I was healed in 2 weeks, but they refused to do the blood work until like a year and a half later. I got pregnant with another child, and they said, oh, you're trying to kill yourself and your children. What happened though? They did the blood work, and what I told them was true. God had indeed healed me, and it was that unforgiveness. I had unforgiveness towards him. I had unforgiveness towards people who had really done things to me. They weren't imagined. You know, they were true, terrible things. But that didn't give me a right to hold that inside. Tuck away unforgiveness and eat your body from the inside out. And that's what was happening at the time. But God restored me. He healed me. I was 225 plus pounds. Not like that anymore. The Lord has done an amazing thing. I am going to be 49 next month. God is miraculous. When that scripture said in Romans 8:11 that gives life to our mortal flesh, he really means it. You might think, are you bragging? I'm bragging to the Lord right now because
that's right.
You're sitting there right now. Some of you may be sitting there in your moments like what I was in those moments prior to some of my healings and miracles that went on. I'm telling you, bad times will not always stay. You will not always be broke. Come on, you're not always. Whatever lie that the devil
told you,
it's a lie.
Jesus, that's
none
right.
None of it's real. None of it's
that's
real.
Right. That's right.
How many times has the enemy tried to kill you? You know, when I was sterile and birthed yet 7 children, they didn't tell me there was one thing wrong. The devil was like, I have to convince this woman she will never, ever have kids. They said, endometriosis. Nope, never can. I said, oh, no, I don't need that. Then they said, short little face. Never going to happen. Didn't believe that either. Chemical imbalance in the blood, your hormones. Nope, don't believe that either. And it just went on. There were like 9 different things. They just kept listing stuff. Oh, hole in the uterus, tubes were clogged, ovarian cysts. I mean, they just kept naming stuff. And I'm like, I'm not having any pain. I'm not having any of these symptoms. This is a lie. So every time something bad comes, the quicker you tell that thing, you're tired of lie. Lost your job, I'm not jobless. That's a lie. That's the circumstance. I'm not jobless. Can't wait for those new people to call me. I bet it's going to be any time now. That is lying. It looks like there's no money in your bank account. That's a lot. Yep. I can remember having like, I don't know, $35 in the bank. And the Lord said, you can have a yard man this year. I could have sat on my butt and said, oh, well, yeah, at some point I will. Who knows when that's going to happen. But instead he said, call a yard man. $35 in the bank and I tell a yard man to come. Still had $35 in the bank. Half an hour after I told the yard man to come, money hit the PayPal. Not money for just 1 week, but to pay in 2. God is that good. When I need plane tickets, come on. It's called obedience. Faith is a movement. Faith is doing. Faith is doing in obeying God. When God said, I want you to go to Texas, I need 2 plane tickets. 2, not 1, man. I need 2 rounds of tickets. That kind of gets expensive. I said, oh, why?
That's right. Amen.
And work towards it and step towards it.
Yes.
$35 in the bank. Shifts over here. You don't see the hurdle anymore. You're jumping over the hurdle and through the hoops, but you don't even know it because they shifted out of your way. and you just step into obedience.
Amen.
Amen.
So I don't know who you want to come down here and pray with us or whatnot, but I want y'all to come to be prayed over, to be loved on, to get some words of knowledge. Any wisdom, knowledge is, you know, I can just tell you like I've done now. Sometimes I get, you know, names or numbers or certain things that's very specific. And sometimes it's less specific. That's, you know, a word of knowledge. A word of wisdom would be more like a strategy for your situation or something about your future. That's wisdom. That's that prophetic words of wisdom. But then there's healing. See, there's gifts of healing. And healing is in the room. I can feel that very healing.
Oh, yes. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
Stage 4 cancer is gone. People's backs lined up and straightened up. Cancer on the uterus went. Breast cancer went. I think I already mentioned that stage 4 liver cancer. Cancer is just a word. It's an infirmity and it has to go. Can't stay. Can't stay. It has to submit. Everything has to stay.
Amen.
Stay.
Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
Don't try to come up here right now.
Hallelujah.
I don't know if y'all want to play some music right now or not, but I just want to try to come up here and we just start praying. I want y'all to come up here and I'm going to pray for y'all. She's going to pray for y'all. So y'all come on up here. Everybody get out of your seats and just come on up here. We're going to start praying. And I'm going to take these out of my ears because your private stuff doesn't need to be cast everywhere. People seeing something is one thing, hearing something is another. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Especially.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.